Interesting between Dr. Mahesh and Dr. Arya. Actually, my topic is echo images which change the course of management or the surgical plans. If I have to continue with this lecture, probably I have to agree with Dr. Mahesh that he is mandatory in all the cases. Suppose I agree with Rajesh, then I think I can not do this talk at all. That's what I feel. That's my personal this thing. This is a very vague this thing. For me, it is difficult to recollect the echo images which actually change the management of the course. I mean, there have been innumerable. I don't know which to accumulate and present it in a format. So whatever I could think of, I have made it into a presentation. Probably I would do justice to this talk actually. First of all, can I have the slide? In the course. If you look at the role of TE in the intraoperative settings, it is definitely established that diagnosis and direct definitive therapies in these patients is present in about 80% of the patients. And one third of these patients may have a change in the medical therapy, while about 9% of the patients have a change in the surgical procedures or the management actually. The patients may have changed the medical therapy, while about 9% may have a change in the surgical procedures. Now, this is one of the papers from Annals of Thoracic Surgery 2008 that intraoperative TE influences the cardiac surgical decisions more than 9% of the patients. Actually, with the greatest impact being observed in a combined procedure, especially CABG, the valve procedures. So, I will go through this scenario in form of some case scenarios which we had problems actually. During my, after I have learned TE actually for the past about 7 years, there's some of the case scenarios. This is very recently we had about 2.5 months back. We've taken a 64-year-old scheduled for a aortic valve replacement due to calcific aortic stenosis, okay, with a normal LV function and the normal coronaries. The aortic valve was replaced using a bioprosthetic valve, a 21mm perimount valve. During closure, actually, the patient developed sort of a bradycardia and hypertension with anterior-wall ST elevations and a QRS widening. Immediately what we thought probably post-CPB would think of an air embolism into the right coronary, but actually extensive de-airing has been done. But if you look, we looked at the 12-lead ECG, it was showing ST elevations more so in the anterior-wall chest leads, but the 2-3 AVF didn't show any changes actually. So we went back on pump. And probably the surgeon had already decided to do some vein grafting to the LAD, probably. It was decided. So I did a routine comprehensive TE. Normally what I do is, in order to improvise my skills, I tend to do a very comprehensive imaging thoroughly. And especially I try to look at the even the coronaries in the short axis of the aortic valve to improve the coronary anatomy, to visualize it, or to improve my skills in visualizing the coronaries. So as a routine, this thing, when we observe, if you look at this short axis of this thing, I observed there is some small sort of a plaque coming in and out into the left main. This is a query. I told the surgeon probably there is something there. I'm not sure about it. Probably he can open up the aorta and just have a look at it. Actually, the surgeon agreed to that, opened the aorta, and inspection of the coronaries revealed a small calcific plaque sitting in the left main. So he didn't do anything, in fact. This is just chance occurrence. Luckily, we declamped, and then we waited for half an hour. Waited for the rhythm to settle down, the ST is settled down, and then we came off pump uneventfully. We didn't have any problem. We closed and shifted to the ICU. If you look at the studies part, has shown that transesophageal echo is useful in detecting left main disease. But actually, TE has not gained any clinical acceptance. The limitation is because we are unable to visualize the distal vessel anatomy, and basically we use the transesophageal echo to see for echo evaluation, especially in case of assessment of the regional wall motion abnormalities. The second case, we had a 70-year-old scheduled for a coronary bypass surgery. The transthoracic echo revealed a mild mitral regurgitation with the moderate LV dysfunction the patient had, and with the ejection fraction of 35%. Then when I did the routine TE, I could make out there was a moderate MR in this with the effective regurgitation orifice area between 0.35 to 0.4, it was there. And then I zoomed this thing in the four-chamber view. I could make out there is severe prolapse of one of the segments, probably the P3 segment of seen. And in the 2D on the right side, you could make out the prolapse. Actually, if you clearly observe the 2D, you can see one of the flail segments oscillating there at the tip of the P3 scallop. It is actually a flail segment there. P3 prolapse with the flailty was seen. And this is a bird's eye view of the 3D image. We can see out there's a flail segment oscillating in the left atrium. Then here with this, probably after informing the surgeon, the surgical plan was changed. Instead of doing only the CABG, he did a mitral valve repair with the ring anaplasty after the CABG. And of course, we came off pump electively, putting him on an intra-aortic balloon pump. But the post-operative was an uneventful period. Third case, we have another case of a severe aortic stenosis scheduled for aortic valve replacement. Came off pump, routine TE. See, in this long axis view, I could make out there was a jet crossing across the anterior surface of the anterior mitral leaflet. Probably, I informed the surgeon, probably there was an aorto atrial fistula created during the surgery because of the calcific aortic stenosis. Anyway, the surgeon went back on pump and we clamped this thing, he opened the aorta and then tried to probe the valve basically. Actually, one of the probe was able to go very smoothly into the across the annulus between the annulus, aortic annulus and the non-coronary cusp. Then probably then he took another stitch from outside basically and then closed it back and came off pump. Then we say post this correction, then we could see a small jet. You can see that the very mild systolic flow flowing into the left atrium. And we, on the right hand side, if you can see, we gave the protamine in this patient and that disappeared, in fact. Probably that echo has definitely helped to a certain extent, a very large extent in this case. The fourth one, we have another patient scheduled for with a moderate LV dysfunction scheduled for a coronary artery. The surgical plan was, because of the LV dysfunction, the surgeon had planned for a Lima and saphenous vein graft, probably under CPP if the patient is able to tolerate. And we did a routine TE. In this patient, I could see in the long axis, we could see something oscillating there. This was a grade 5 plaque, probably. And you can see the whole of the calcific area in the posterior surface of the ascending aorta. And in the upper residual aortic arch axis, we see a grade 4 plaque oscillating there. And in the same patient, we saw a grade 5 plaque there in the descending aorta. That means the whole of the entire aorta from the ascending arch to the descending was very plaquey. Okay. Then the surgeon decided that to reverse the plan, not doing on pump, probably we put him on inodilators and he decided to do a total arterial revascularization and an off pump. Of course, postoperatively we ventilated him for 48 hours and then of course we extubated him after 2 days. This is another fifth case. This is a 71-year-old who was transferred to the ward after a coronary bypass. On the fourth day, evening or something, the patient developed signs of low output. He was brought to the ICU actually. And he was on the verge of an arrest, actually ventilated him. And transthoracic echo, we tried doing it, but it was not successful because the windows were not all right. Then we did a routine TE. We could make out in the fourth chamber, we could see the large, huge hematoma compressing the RV wall. It was invaginating into the RA. Okay, and then that was evacuated. And then you could see on the right-hand side, the RA, when the clot was removed, this thing, and of course, the hemodynamics improved. Actually, per se, if you look at the papers regarding this, the localized thrombus may cause compression in the cardiac chambers without signs of tamponade, basically. So we have to look out for possibilities of localized hematomas should be considered, and you have to search it very diligently, either by transthoracic echo or transesophageal for abnormal cardiac masses, basically. Okay. Actually, if you look at the surgical, this thing, the size of the hematoma which is compressing and causing a hemodynamic instability was very small. Look at this thing which is compressing there. This is another case of a 38-year-old scheduled for a coronary bypass, normal LV. And they had transthoracic had given a concentric elevation with a mild MR. Okay, I did a routine TE. I diagnosed to have a SAM. There was systolic anterior motion in the LV, and we did a septal with the anterior mitral leaflet height and the posterior mitral leaflet height were nearly equal. So the AL to PL ratio was something like it was about 1. Normally, it has to be about 2. It is about 1, less than 1.2 or something. And the CSEP distance was only 19. And there was a moderate MR in this patient. Now, in the long axis view, mid-esophageal, you can make out the SAM occurring there. And you see the posterior mitral leaflet is much of the same length as the anterior mitral leaflet. Okay. Now, if you look at in this view, there was a typical Y-shaped jet. This is the flow across the turbulent flow across the LVOT and the MR which is occurring there, which is indicative of a obstructive this thing in case of a HOCM. And in the deep transgastric view, I took a gradient across the LVOT, but it gave a gradient of only about 6 millimeters of mercury. So very surprising. Then actually when we analyzed this thing of the color flow Doppler, in the sea, the turbulence was starting somewhere in the mid cavity. Okay, not only into the LVOT area, it was starting from the mid cavity and extending into the LVOT area. Okay, this was really confusing. I didn't know why the LVOT gradient was very low. Then actually I took a gradient at the in the apical level at the LV apex. It was showing a gradient of only 15, and then I took a gradient in the mid cavity. It got a gradient of 117 to 118 millimeters of mercury. There's probably a mid cavity obstruction. Okay, we informed the surgeon about it. And then we tried optimizing the volume condition because of the SAM. We gave volume, tried to stabilize the heart rate, brought down by giving beta blockers. In fact, we brought up the pressures by using phenylephrine to increase the end systolic volume. But there was no change in this thing. The surgeon decided to do a CABG on the pump. It was basically a two-vessel disease, okay, and repair. So the surgeon now decided that he is not going to, because it was a mid-cavity obstruction, he decided to just do a alferi stitch on this thing to relieve the SAM. Post this thing, aortic valve long axis, this is the alferi stitch which he had taken. This is the distance between the CSEP distance had increased from about, 16 mm or something, it went up to around 23, okay. And the color flow Doppler, it showed a very mild jet across this thing, and the gradient had come down, not very much, but definitely it had come down to a large extent. This is one of the cases of a 59-year-old scheduled for an MVR. Mitral valve replaced, and the surgeon had placed it in the anti-anatomical position. We came off pump and did a routine TE evaluation. Now, basically, when you have a prosthetic valve, especially a bileaflet mechanical valve, if he has placed it in the anti-anatomical position, normally we have to see a single leaflet moving in the four-chamber view. You can make out one of the leaflet has been stuck in the closed position. In the mitral commissural view also, you can see only one of the leaflet moved, and in the large axis. In the long axis also, the leaflet is basically closed. What we would be interested, because it's anti-anatomical, I wanted to see both the leaflets oscillating in the, one of the leaflets oscillating in this thing, but in the mitral commissural and the long axis, we have to see both the leaflets oscillating. Okay, then when he rotated the valve and released the tag and we came off pump, you could see in the long axis, we could see both the leaflets oscillating there, and the 3D shows normally functioning bileaflet mechanical valve. Okay, actually prosthetic valves, actually if you look at in the post-operative period, probably it's easier to diagnose. Actually, by using a fluoroscopy, this is one of the cases you can see a double valve replacement is done. The aortic leaflet, both of them can be seen opening, but the only one of the leaflets in the mitral position can be seen there. So fluoroscopy is also one of the good methods, imaging tools for diagnosing a prosthetic valve dysfunctions. Okay. Actually, this is an additional side which I pulled just while sitting in the other hall in the hall here. I just remembered about, I don't have images of this. My colleague Dr. Praveen is sitting here in the audience. We were doing a TURP, a 60-year-old guy with everything normal, no comorbidities, everything, normal echo, doing a TURP and a spinal. So at the end of surgery, I received a call that the patient has arrested. So they were massaging. In fact, I've joined in. So we massaged for about, 20 minutes. There was no response. Actually, the ECG on this thing, monitor, we see it was a normal electrocardiogram was running actually. We felt the pulse, no this thing. Then we secured a central venous access, put a femoral line in spite of the massage. We went in. 20 minutes we could not. Then suddenly I thought of, let us introduce a TE probe. I introduced the TE probe and saw there was a massive air embolism in the right heart. So because we had a central line, we tried aspirating whatever is possible, but continued the massage. We took about another 45 minutes, say, probably we massaged about 1 hour 45 minutes. We started on epinephrine and everything to kick the heart. Basically, after, say, about 1 hour 15 minutes or something, the heart started beating. We could make it out on the echo, this thing. Then we stabilized him, waited for another 3 to 3.5 hours in the operating rooms. Then we weaned off the epinephrine, stabilized him completely with the normal ECG. Then, in fact, we sent the blood investigations for routine cardiac enzymes, which later on came to be normal. We shifted him to the ICU, ventilated him for 48 hours. Then we extubated him on the third day. Of course, he had some mild cerebral irritability, but he went back home on the 12th day or 13th day, I think so. But I think definitely Echo has done a very big help in this, because I was thinking basically if you are not able to resuscitate him for half an hour, basically a normal patient who had a normal echocardiogram, I was unable to come to him. In fact, we were tired of continuing the CPR. Probably Echo, the findings in the Echo probably made us to continue the massage probably and then resuscitate him successfully. Okay, these are some of the literatures we are having. We see that detailed or comprehensive examination has to be done preferably to validate the preoperative findings and to avoid unnecessary interventions and associated morbidity. Actually, TE, which was emerging as a technological curiosity, has become an invaluable tool in the operating rooms now. And with more and more complex surgeries being done, heart surgeries being done, I think it will definitely continue to become an essential tool. Thank you very much.